Hello everyone, my name is Ajmeddin, and first of all, before I start, I just want to thank to you, show my gratitude that thank you for being into my channel, and now we are more than 1000 people here, and that is very nice thing for me, very motivational. I try to make videos which you ask me to have, but sometimes I got a day job, so I can't make each and every of them. I try to make them, but I only get time in Saturday, Sundays, weekends, and because of the day job as well. So pardon me for the videos which I couldn't make, but I try to make videos as you asked me to make about. So here's another video for you, which is sample question papers for the May 2019 examination. These questions, sample questions, are issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants. So we are going to cover up 20 questions in this video. Part one is there, part two will be covering another 20 or maybe 30 questions. So in this video we are going to cover up 20 questions and with the answers. So without wasting any time, let us begin with the first question, which is which of the following is not an assertion about presentation and disclosure. So occurrence is the assertion, completeness is an assertion, classification is also an assertion, but existence is not an assertion, and the correct answer would be existence. And accuracy and valuation is another assertion, which is about presentation and disclosures, which includes financial and other information are disclosed fairly and at the appropriate amount. So therefore existence is a it's not an assertion, and if anything else could have been there apart from the existence, it should be accuracy and valuation. Next is determining a percentage to be applied to the chosen benchmark in relation to materiality involves exercise of your professional judgment, because it is my judgment, it is the auditor's judgment, that what amount could be, what percentage could be the material. For example, for me 10%, 20%, 15%, 2%, that is my judgment, my experience which came up with me, which allows me to have that, okay, let us check the sample size of like this percentage or this that percentage. This is my professional judgment. Next is, which of the following factors is or are considered to be determining the sample size of the test of controls? So apart from projected error, tolerable error, and the expected error are the factors which are considered in determining the sample size. So therefore D, option D, is a correct answer. And next, because if there is an increase in the tolerable rate of deviation, then sample size will decrease. As lower the tolerable rate of deviation, larger the sample size needs to be. Next is, which of the following is not an analytical procedure? Okay, so analytics, whenever we talk about analytical procedure, we always first thing which came is comparison. So wherever the comparison is there about financial, non-financial, whatever the case may be, comparison, we are comparing with anything, it includes in the analytical procedure. But tracing of the purchases, recurring in the purchase book to purchase invoices, when you are watching and you are seeing, okay, these purchases are recurring in nature, okay, we are purchasing again and again the fabric, we are again and again purchasing same kind of fabric from same kind of vendor. So that doesn't include any analytical procedure. Apart from that, comparing aggregate wages, of course, to the number of employees, total of number of employees, okay, 100, and we are paying wages of this much, so average this. So comparing this is an analytical procedure. Comparing actual cost with the standard cost is an analytical procedure. But tracing of purchases, recurring in the purchase books to the purchase invoices, is not an analytical procedure. Next, we come up with the agreed terms of audit engagement shall recorded in what? In should be recorded, should it be recorded in an audit engagement letter or an audit engagement letter or any other suitable form of written engagement? So of course the option B is correct answer, because the agreed terms of audit engagement, it should be recorded in audit engagement letter or any form of written agreements which is given to the management, which is definitely agreed with the management. Next is, and of course it shall include the objective and scope of the audit and responsibility of auditor and responsibility of management. And next is, if law or regulation prescribes the sufficient detail of the terms of the audit engagement, then what if the auditor needs to record them in the option A, in the written agreement, except for the fact that such law and regulation apply to the management and the management acknowledges the same, or the auditor need not to record them in a written agreement. Of course, when anything is prescribed under a law, so auditor need not to record them in the written agreement, but he needs to and ensure that management understands its responsibilities, that okay, certain kind of things are written there in the law, and therefore option A is the correct answer. Next is SA 700 requires the use of specific headings. Okay, SA 700 says that you need to, when you are jotting down your report, when you are reporting on the audit, so you need to define certain kind of headings in your audit report, which includes key audit matters, basis of opinion, date. So therefore option D is the correct answer. All of the above, D was the correct answer. Next is, what are the analytical procedures? Substantive test designed to assess control risk, or substantive test designed to evaluate the validity of management representation letter? No, the option C is the correct answer, which is substantive test designed to study relationships between financial and non-financial data. So the analytical procedure are the test which are designed to study the relationship comparison between the financial non-financial status. Next is analytical procedure issued in planning stage of an audit generally helps in what? In determining the nature and timing of extent of the audit procedure, of course, yes. Determining attention to the potential risk areas, yes. And indicates important aspect of the business, of course, yes. So it is option number D, all of the above. Next is, tolerable error is a maximum monetary error that the auditor is prepared to accept in the population and still concludes that the audit objective has been achieved, is directly related to the materiality. Because tolerable error, whenever we think about it, of course, that previous question was about the sample size, the factors, but this time it relates to the materiality. Next is, source of non-sampling risk. What are the sources of non-sampling risk? Before I read down the options, I should clarify, the non-sampling risk are the risks that auditors reaches and erroneous conclusions for any reason not related to the sampling risk. So it includes human mistakes, it includes applying audit procedure not appropriate for the objective of audit, and it also includes the misinterpretation of the sampling results. So all of the above is the correct answer. We are now in question number 13, and the request from the client for the auditor to change the audit engagement, or to change the engagement, may result from whenever the client is asking that okay, let us change in the engagement, it results in any circumstances which are affecting the need of the services. It also affect the some misunderstanding of the nature of audit and relating the service originally requested, and the restriction on the scope of the engagement. So all of the above is the correct answer. Next is and then the auditor would consider carefully the reason given on the request by the client, particularly the implication of the restriction on the scope of the engagement, especially the legal and contractual obligations and implications, we can say. Next is SA 230, definition of audit documentation is all about. It refers to the record and audit procedures performed relevant to the audit, evidence obtained, and conclusions the auditor reached is of course defined in the audit documentation. It is also referred in the SA 230, which is definition of audit documentation. Next is completion of the assembly of the final audit file after the date of auditor's report is an administrative procedure. We know that after audit is completed, now we are compiling the audit file. It should not include any new kind of and it is not like we are drawing a new kind of conclusion, because we have already done our audit. it is just an administrative procedure. You know, we need to have a quality control over the whatever the data we have collected, you know, we need to compile them. That's why it's an administrative process that doesn't include any, you know, involvement of any performance of new audit procedure or drawing new conclusions. So the right answer is C, an administrative procedure. Because we are compiling just the audit, whatever the our findings are, we are just compiling them. We have already concluded, we have already reported the things in our audit report. Now next is issues of audit programs, analysis issue, memoranda, summarizes of significant matters are examples of audit documentation. Audit documentation examples are audit programs, analysis, issues of memorandum and summaries of significant findings and matters. Next is the auditors shall assemble the audit documentation in dash in audit file, of course. And next, because audit documentation is, it's an administrative procedure for assembling the audit file on timely basis after the date of audit report. Next is dash refers to an attitude that includes questioning mind. Auditor go to the to any audit and he asks, okay, why you are doing this, why you are doing that, this is the wrong process, that is the wrong process, whatever the process you are doing, it seems to be incorrect, it seems to be risky for the entity, it seems to be financially impactful. So this is called as professional skepticism. This is a professional skepticism refer to an attitude of an auditor that includes a questioning mind, being alert, whatever the conditions which may be indicate possible misstatement due to error or fraud, a critical thinking also is, a professional skepticism, which is very important for being an auditor, a good auditor. Next is according to SA 210, and next and last is this, the audit according to SA 210, agreeing the terms of audit engagement, the auditor shall agree the terms of the audit engagement, which of these, with the management or those charged with governance, and with them, whenever you are agreeing with the terms of engagement, you need to apply, you need to reach out with the management or those charged with governance, TCWG. So that means, or it is not like mandatory that you need to apply with the management, you need to reach out the management as well and the TCWG. No, you can go for either management or TCWG, whichever is appropriate for that instance. For example, you are going to be a statutory auditor, of course, if it is a listed entity, you need to reach out with the audit committee, which is those charged with governance, not the management or the CFO of the company. You need to agree with the audit committee in that for instance. So option D is the correct answer. So thank you very much for being here, and I hope this is a pretty long video, but we have able to cover up 20 questions. We are going to cover up next 20 or maybe 30 in the next video. Thank you very much.